It's a great pleasure to introduce you Dr. Myrna Perez Sheldon. She is a postdoctoral fellow at the Center for the Study of Women, Gender, and Sexuality at Rice University. She received her PhD from Harvard University, History of Science Department, in 2014. She has held research fellowships at the Darwin Correspondence Project at Cambridge University, United Kingdom, the Huntington Library, and the Harvard Divinity School. Her work concentrates on the relationships between American politics, evolutionary science, religious communities, and concepts of race, gender, and sexuality. Her first book uses the public career of Harvard evolutionary biologist Stephen Jay Gould to examine the impact of American creationism on evolutionary science and the politics of scientific expertise in the 1980s. Ongoing research projects include the role of evolutionary frameworks in shaping contemporary evangelical understandings of gender and the religious politics of American environmentalism. Her second book project investigates the relationship between evolutionary science and Christian theology in American cultural understandings of race. Myrna will be joining the faculty at Ohio University in the fall of 2016 as a tenure track assistant professor of gender and American religion, jointly appointed in the Department of Classics and World Religions and the Women's Gender and Sexuality Studies Program. Her talk today is entitled Public Ethics, Politics, and Sociobiology. It is about Wilson and Gould. As you recall, we had another seminar about Wilson in the fall from a different perspective. So it looks like it's Wilson's year, at least for this seminar. With this, let us welcome our speaker.
Thank you. Can you all hear me well enough? Wonderful. Thank you for that wonderful introduction, and thank you to all of you for having me here today. It's really a delight for me to be part of this fantastic series and what is really a wonderful program here that you all get to enjoy and take part of. And as Janet said, I'm a historian of evolutionary biology, and I'm particularly interested in the relationship between evolutionary biology, religion, and gender in the American context. So today I'm going to be talking to you about sort of a slice from my book manuscript that I worked on for my doctoral project. And really what I'm going to be talking to you about is this moment in American history when the politics of scientific expertise change for evolutionary biologists what they understand their public moral duty is as biologists. So I'm going to describe that a bit and then also talk about how this change in their public duty also affects the way they're engaging in technical debates within the biological sciences. So where I want to start us is with an assertion that American creationism is something new in the 1980s. Now, if you know anything about American creationism, this might be a surprising thing to say, because we often think of it in the American context as being something very old, as something that begins at least in the beginning of the 20th century. You may have heard of the Scopes trial in 1925. We sort of think of creationism as just a feature of American political life. But something that I found in my historical work is that the 1980s is really a new and different moment for creationism. And there's several reasons why this is. On the one hand, this is the first moment when creationism asserts itself as a science. Creationists are saying that they are a science and a scientific alternative to evolution, and this is something new. Secondly, creationism is tied to the new Christian right in the 1980s. It's tied to the rise of Reagan. It becomes part of the evangelical Republican political platform, something which is very familiar to us even today. But this is the sort of first moment that creationism is on the national scene in this way. And then thirdly, and really importantly for our story, the 1980s are the first moment when evolutionary biologists collect themselves in explicit activist groups to combat creationism. And something I found in my archival work was the formation of grassroots organizations that eventually developed into more official nonprofit organizations that were devoted to combating creationism. And again, this is something new in the 1980s. So when I found this in my historical work, when I found that there's this new moment in the 1980s, I realized that I had to understand differently a whole set of debates and controversies that these very same biologists were involved in just a decade before. And what I found was that creationism introduced a whole new landscape onto a scene that already had a debate, and that debate was sociobiology. In the 1970s, this new research field of sociobiology, you may have heard of some of it if you went to the previous talk about Wilson, already had biologists debating with one another, both in their technical work and then also in their public life. So what creationism does is it introduces a new set of communities, political communities, religious communities, new audiences, and it changes a lot for these biologists. So this is what we're going to think about today. Now, as I've already hinted at, sociobiology begins in the 1970s, and really, even though it has earlier roots, people really see it as beginning with the publication of E.O. Wilson's book, Sociobiology, in 1975. And in this book, E.O. Wilson is calling for a new field of research that would utilize already existing tools in evolutionary biology to study social behavior. And in the book, he is making the case that these tools can be used to study the social behavior of all kinds of, well, animals, organisms. But in the last chapter, a very famous chapter, he also asserts that we can use these tools to understand human and human society. And he makes the case that we should understand things like gender roles, religious belief, aggression, that these are best understood by studying the evolutionary origins of humans. So when the book was published, and Wilson was and is a professor at Harvard, there were a number of circles at Harvard that reacted very strongly to this last chapter. And there were a particular set of people at Harvard and sort of surrounding communities that felt that Wilson's arguments supported traditional ideas of gender, that it maybe supported sexism, that supported patriarchy. And these groups organized themselves into a group that came to be called the Sociobiology Study Group. And they wanted to criticize and sort of caution people in taking Wilson, in thinking that Wilson was just objective truth on these matters. So what we see in these very public altercations that happened at Harvard and in a few years afterwards is that Wilson and his critics had two very different ideas about the relationship between science and American democracy. So let me break that down slightly. So Wilson is what I would call a more classic liberal, has a more classically liberal view of the relationship between science and democracy. Wilson believes that science is necessary for an enlightened society, that science is sort of the basis for enlightened civic virtues. And so what you ought to do as a scientist is to do good science and make sure that it isn't misinterpreted or overly criticized in the public setting. Now his critics, who identified as leftists and radical scientists and also feminists, they were more concerned that science could oppress people. These were people who were involved in the new environmental movements, they were involved in anti-nuclear warfare movements, and they saw science as having a hand in the sort of destructive nature of Western society. And so they felt that democracy needed the people to critique and criticize science. So you can already see there's these two really fundamentally different notions of what scientists ought to be doing in relation to the public. Now, what happens when creationists come onto the scene is you already have these two groups who have a different idea of what science and American democracy, how they should relate to one another. On the one hand, science should be opened up. This is a cover from the magazine, the radical science organization, Science for the People. Science needs to be opened up for the people. On the other hand, you have Wilson, who believes that science needs to be, in some sense, shielded from public criticism, that scientists know best how to do their research and also present their research to the public. But what you get when creationism comes onto the scene is you have this whole new set of authority that's possible. Creationists are arguing that the assumptions of methodological naturalism and metaphysical naturalism in science are maybe not correct, They're also offering up religion as a whole new source of moral authority in American democracy. So this introduction shifts and complicates the landscape that sociobiology was already occupying. So what I'm going to do today is to see in greater detail this shift, how it happens, how it happened at Harvard, and I do this through the lens of Stephen Jay Gould. Now, partly I do this because I wrote my dissertation on Stephen Jay Gould, so he's the one that I know the most about. I worked in his archive. But I also, Stephen Jay Gould is a particularly good window onto this shift. And this is partly because Gould was a leftist scientist. He participated in these radical science organizations that I was just describing. And so he's on the other side of the debates with Wilson in the 1970s. On the other hand, he's also a very public, one of the most public defenders of Darwinian evolution once the creationists come onto the scene. So we can sort of use Gould's career to follow these shifts as they happen politically. The last reason why Gould is such a useful window is all along the way, Gould is advocating for new revisions to technical parts of Darwinian evolution. So even as he's engaged in these political contests with Wilson, even as he's defending evolution against creationism, all along the way he's trying to promote his own distinctive version of Darwinism. And as we'll see, people read this promotion on his part differently in these different political moments. So one of the things that I'll be concentrating on in particular is Gould's developing criticism of what he called adaptationism in sociobiology. And we'll see how Gould becomes very critical of the way in which sociobiology understands natural selection to be a kind of optimizing engineer. And I'll lay out some of the sort of scientific and technical reasons why Gould is critical of this in sociobiology, but then also discuss that he also thinks of it as a moral issue. So that'll be sort of the center of what we concentrate on. So this is the cover of Time magazine from 1977, and the title read, Why You Do What You Do, Sociobiology, a New Theory of Behavior. And I think of this Time magazine cover as this sort of introduction of sociobiology onto a broad public stage. The article interviewed Wilson and also another sociobiologist, Robert Trivers, and introduced the theory as a new and exciting sort of bold way of understanding human nature. And as you can see, already the sort of implications for the cover is that sociobiology is going to explain in an objective scientific manner why men and women relate to each other in the way that they do, why our society is organized in the manner that it is. And sociobiology had a kind of confidence to it because it was drawing upon already existing tools and models of evolutionary biology. So on the one hand, it's using a lot of the models from the population genetic synthesis of the mid-century, but it's also drawing upon new understandings of heredity that actually come out of molecular genetics and evolving technologies around protein synthesis. And one of the things that sociobiology draws on is in this new way of thinking of heredity as informational. So no longer were geneticists thinking of genes as simply markers, things that we could follow through breeding programs, but actually that genes were packets of information that could convey information across generations. So sociobiologists pick up on this language. They're not largely molecular biologists or geneticists themselves, for the most part, although there's some exceptions to this. And they use this notion to think about genes as these kind of timeless connections between our evolutionary past and our present. So things happen in our evolutionary past, they're encoded into our genes, and then they continue to sort of dictate us in the present. And in this article and other spaces, sociobiologists use a lot of language like that our genes are our puppets, or that we follow their programming as if we are the computer, or we're the computers and our genes are the sort of software that dictates us. So you get the sense of a kind of deterministic way of thinking about heredity and evolution. So, and one of the things that you find in a lot of the sociobiological literature in the late 70s and early 1980s, and this is in Wilson's work, is this idea that gender relationships were formed really distinctly in our evolutionary past. And sociobiologists envisioned our evolutionary past as being something very akin to the African savanna, the drawing on some earlier discoveries that located the human evolutionary origin in Africa. And so they have this kind of visual of savanna life where men are hunting, women are at home, men are aggressively competing sexually for women. They're kind of going out into the competitive world, whereas women stay in small family circles and kind of tend to the children. So you can see this language in, this is a quote from sociobiology, Muslim sociobiology, and he says, "The building block of nearly all human societies is the nuclear family. The populace of the American industrial city, no less than a band of hunter-gatherers in the Australian desert, is organized around this unit. During the day, the women and children remain in the residential area, while the men forage for game, or its symbolic equivalent in the form of barter and money." So when this book is published, as I said, there are a number of groups who read this kind of language, and they're incensed that this book, which has all the authority of a Harvard biology professor, is promoting what they felt were very deterministic and traditional and patriarchal ways of understanding gender. And so the group, as I said, formed, called the Sociobiology Study Group. This is a paper from one of their, the archive of their meeting minutes. And it's listing all of their publications that are explicitly criticizing Wilson. So I should emphasize that the Sociobiology Study Group is consciously and carefully publicly criticizing Wilson. They want to detract from what they believe is his credibility. And here in number 11, is an article by Gould, which I'll talk about more in a moment. But so Gould not only goes to these meetings, he's sort of seen as one of their key players in defeating and criticizing Wilson. Now, a lot of the people who engaged in the sociobiology study group understood themselves or described themselves as what were called radical scientists. And these were professional scientists who wanted to understand how scientific work could create a more just and equal world. And many of these scientists had either participated in the civil rights movement, they were participating in the emerging women's movement. Many of them, as I said, are also participating in anti-nuclear and anti-nuclear armament movement. So they're part of this change and kind of upswelling of protest movements in American society, but they're also professional scientists. So they're trying to understand how these two things can go together. And one of the ways that they began to understand how these two things could come alongside each other, professional research and these kind of radical politics, is the idea that we need to open up science to the people. We need to publicly criticize science for the people. Now, Gould was quite typical of this kind of profile of scientists. So he, as an undergrad, participated in the civil rights movement. These are photos from a sit-in that he engaged in Ohio to integrate a barbershop. And these are photos that he didn't take them, but he saved them from the sit-in. And it's hard to see, but he's here in the corner sort of watching what's going on. So I think this is really important to remember when we think about the sociobiology debate. Gould is entering the campus at Harvard just a few short years after these experiences. Harvard itself is engaged in a number of student takeovers and student protests. It's kind of a time of upheaval and protest. So now Gould is particularly interesting because although he was, as an undergrad, engaged in explicit protest movements, and he was, as I said, a member of the Sociobiology Study Group, Gould himself didn't really like political organizing. He didn't like to understand himself as a primarily political person, and he sort of wanted to understand himself more as an independent and intellectual. And so he wanted to understand, how can I use my intellectual work for these ethics of equality and justice? And so he turns to public writing, and he began writing for Natural History magazine. If you know anything about Gould, you may be familiar with his column in Natural History, which was later bound into a series of anthologies. And he starts writing for Natural History magazine in 1974. And what I found in the archive is, in his exchanges with his editor, he explicitly sees this public writing as a way of engaging with public, with social justice. So this is from a letter that he wrote his to-be editor at Natural History, and he said, "I think I would like to do a column firmly based in evolutionary theory and its implications, but trying to synthesize under that rubric my divergent interests in the history and philosophy of science, social and political questions bearing upon scientific issues, and the phenomena of life's history on a grand scale." So for Gould, public writing was not simply a way of educating the public or conveying already understood scientific research to a generalized audience. It was a way of engaging with an explicit moral program while also discussing the kinds of things he found in evolution and the history and philosophy of evolution that he found particularly interesting. So Gould begins his column in 1974, and he's writing it for about a year before Sociobiology is published, and a couple years before the criticisms of Wilson start after 1975. So, and the column is published monthly, so Gould has this ready-made public platform in which he can engage with a number of kind of timely controversies. And the timing of the publication, you know, he can write a column in a couple weeks and it'll be published in Natural History. So there's a very short time scale in terms of the publication. So he has this venue and all of the hubbub of the sociobiology controversy starts. And so he decides to use his column to address the sociobiology issue and to talk about his criticisms of Wilson and his criticisms of sociobiology. So he writes the column, this is early in the spring of 1976, and he decides to send the column to Wilson before it's published. Now I should emphasize, which maybe I haven't emphasized before, is that Wilson and Gould were colleagues at Harvard, and their offices were just a few kind of down the hall and around the corner from each other. So they're colleagues. What's interesting is that they actually write letters to each other all the time, which is strange to me, but it's useful for me. So Gould decides, he writes this column and he sends it to Wilson. And the column, which was published, is called Biological Potential versus Biological Determinism. And it comes out in May of 1976. And this particular copy is Gould's copy of the column because he would later edit the columns before they got put into the anthologies. Just a side note. So in March, a couple months before the column comes out, Gould writes to Wilson and he says, I debated intensely with myself before writing the May column at all. At this point, I wish nothing more than restored harmony. There he's referring to this, already been all this kind of animosity. Nonetheless, I realized one day that I'm the only popularist writing a regular feature on evolution. How could I ignore the most widely discussed event in evolutionary biology during my brief career? And you see here that Gould is asserting this kind of moral duty, right? Like he has this public venue. He feels he's compelled to talk about sociobiology. So Wilson writes him back almost immediately. Again, I love that they like are writing, they like type it up and send it to their secretaries. It's very formal. And he says to Gould, you're continuing a partisan attack, essentially identical in its arguments to that used by Science for the People. Science for the People was the parent organization of the sociobiology study group. In an important forum, there he's referring to Natural History magazine, where I will have no chance to reply. It appears to me that you are showing not only poor judgment with reference to your own university, but also dubious ethics in promoting your point of view concerning a highly political, controversial topic. And elsewhere in the letter, Wilson explicitly says that Gould is putting forward a controversy before a public that isn't ready to interpret or understand it. So Wilson is completely incensed that Gould will do this. He feels affronted. He feels that it's unfair for Gould to take advantage of this public platform in this way. And Wilson is very concerned that he won't have the opportunity to respond. So then the correspondence gets slightly complicated. So Gould writes back and says, I'm so sorry, of course you'll be able to respond. You know, you can write your response now and we'll publish them together. So Wilson actually writes a whole response to the column, primarily attacking Gould for his political arguments rather than for his scientific ones. Gould doesn't like this at all and writes back and says, this is so upsetting, I can't believe that you would only engage me in the politics and not the science. There are all these letters back and forth between Wilson and the editor, where Wilson is saying that, you know, Gould is a radical leftist and kind of, you know, implicates that he's this kind of crazy communist and what are you doing? And it all becomes a real mess. And Gould, Wilson finally writes to Gould and says, I'm going to rescind my response. I'm not going to publish my response. And so the column ran in Natural History without Wilson's response. And so the only place to see the response is in the archive. And other than that, there's sort of no record that Wilson had a response to this column. And you can see in the correspondence between Gould and Wilson that this moment really drops off their previously reasonably cordial professional relationship. And it's not until many decades later in the 90s when they start working on some conservation work together that the correspondence sort of picks up again and they're sort of kind to each other. So there's a real falling out on a personal level, but the thing that's so interesting for me is, again, just the stark difference in their understanding of what is the ethical thing to do. Gould feeling, I'm ethically compelled to talk about this controversy in a public venue, and Wilson feeling, this is precisely the opposite of what you should be doing as a scientist. Now, one of the important things in that exchange is that Gould felt that it was unfair for Wilson not to respond to his scientific disagreements or his scientific criticisms of sociobiology. And since that period, one of the things that's very difficult about discussing the sociobiology controversy is the question to the extent to which Gould's criticisms are only political, or the extent to which they are also scientific or at their root scientific, is something that historians, sociologists, journalists, biologists themselves have had very different views. So some people have felt that Gould sort of trumps up his scientific criticisms because he is at base uncomfortable with Wilson's politics. And that was certainly Wilson's perspective. Gould felt much more strongly that he fundamentally disagreed with Wilson's view of evolution, and that this was intimately connected to his political disagreements. What I would say from my perspective is that it is the case that Gould had a much more fluid perspective on the relationship between politics, social context, and science. So for him, he believed that social context was sort of necessarily part of science. And so the fact that his social context influenced the way in which he framed his science, he thought was what everyone was doing. Whereas Wilson sees a much greater distinction. So sort of already on their own terms, it's very difficult, or it can be very difficult to parse weighing in on one side or the other. But I will say that Gould does have a serious and sustained number of criticisms of sociobiology that he carries on basically for the rest of his career. They're not always explicitly framed as criticisms of sociobiology. He frames it as criticisms of adaptive thinking or adaptationism. But it's that piece, that technical piece, is what he is critical of sociobiology and was what he was critical of in the column. And Gould begins through the 1980s and 1990s to level a series of technical attacks on what he sees as the understanding of the evolutionary process in sociobiology. And the first of these comes in 1979 and was by far his most famous criticism. It was a paper that he wrote with Richard Lewontin called The Spandrels of San Marco and the Pangalossian Paradigm, which was read before and then published by the Royal Society of London. And that is easily one of, if not the most iconic of Gould's famous papers. And to this day, if you've done any philosophy of science, you've read this paper many times. It's still very much at the center of what people understand as Gould's criticisms of adaptationism. And importantly, it's in this paper that Gould begins a point, and something that continues to the 1980s and 1990s, that he's critical of the way in which he felt, as Jeff said, this is Gould's perspective, not necessarily my own. The way in which he felt that evolutionary biology and sociobiology in particular, at the time, viewed natural selection as an engineer, an optimizing agent that had sort of no impediments to its ability to engineer good design. So in the paper, he says that he's objecting to the belief that he felt many other biologists had, that there's a kind of near omnipotence of natural selection to forge organic design and fashion the best among all possible worlds. So he's critical of this way of viewing natural selection. Now, we might ask, was it the case that in evolutionary biology that sociobiologists are discussing natural selection as a kind of optimizing engineer? And when you look at the literature, there is certainly a case to be made there. So why might sociobiologists have been thinking of natural selection as an optimizing engineer? So if we think about, a working sociobiologist, they're trying to understand if present day features are adaptations. So ideally what they might do, let's say that they're doing research. I don't know why I said it like that. They're doing their research. And they notice that there's this population of beetles that's all foraging at precisely the same distance. And so our sociobiologist wonders, is this precision of distance some kind of adaptation? So ideally what they would do is they would observe a population over many generations, notice that this trait increased over time, and therefore increasing the fitness of its of those in the population that had it. However, it's generally speaking sometimes very difficult to do this in this ideal way. So it may be the case that you're here in the present and you don't have good evidence of what happened in the past. Or if you are sort of starting from the beginning, you may not have enough time to watch the population go through all the generations that you need to. So biologists began to develop a kind of shortcut. What they tried to do was to look in the present and see, okay, what would be the optimal foraging distance according to some kind of cost-benefit analysis. So if we do an independent cost-benefit analysis of foraging distance, the cost being the energy it takes to forage and the benefit being the food that you get. So you come up with some kind of distance and this kind of cost-benefit model, and then if you compare it to what your beetles are doing, you can then infer all this past, right? So the optimizing model is a way of inferring the past if you don't actually have evidence of the past. Now, Wilson, for instance, when he talked about optimality models, he would describe them as kind of heuristic tools which then could open up for further research. And in many places, people who are using optimality models are not necessarily saying that they're evidence in themselves, but they're a way of directing you to gathering more evidence. Those who were critical of them felt that often, once this comparison had been made, biologists would often stop looking for additional evidence and just decide, yes, this is an adaptation. So now, one of the things that I've been talking about all along is that sociobiologists talk about gender roles and sex difference as a kind of adaptation, an evolutionary adaptation. And one of the reasons that they did this is that they understood sex difference as a kind of two different expressions of cost-benefit strategies in sexual reproduction. So in sexual reproduction, the kind of cost-benefit is sort of obvious, right? The cost is the resources you're investing in reproduction, gametes, bodily energy, food, this sort of thing. And the benefit is offspring. And sociobiologists, beginning with the sociobiologist named Robert Trivers, began to argue that maleness and femaleness were two different ways of dealing with this. Females produced large gametes, invested a lot of resources in a few offspring, whereas males invested very few resources and had small gametes in a lot of offspring. So few offspring, big gametes, small gametes, lots of offspring. And so basically what you get is this idea that females are always trying to get males to invest in a few offspring, whereas males are trying to get a lot of females to have a lot of children with them. And once this model was developed, sociobiologists then extended it to explain lots of things about human relationships. So they used it to explain things like why they felt that women had a tendency to be interested in wealthy men. They used it to explain why they felt that men cheated more. They even used it to explain things like why they felt that men were more successful in professional environments. So they're using quite a technical optimality model to then talk about American gender roles. Now, for a lot of the leftists and particularly feminist criticisms of this kind of sociobiology, a lot of what the criticisms focus on was the gendered language, the kind of rhetoric, these sort of assumptions and gendered stereotypes that critics of sociobiology felt were in the biology. What's interesting about Gould is, although he is a little bit critical of this at the beginning, his criticisms are actually more about the conception of adaptation in sociobiology. So he spends much less time talking about rhetoric and much more time arguing about what an adaptation is. And all along through the 80s and 90s, all of his criticisms of this way of thinking about adaptation are assertions that biologists aren't taking history seriously enough. So if you remember in this slide, the sociobiologists are just inferring the history. Gould's argument begins to be that if we actually look at the evidence of evolutionary history, we have to understand adaptation differently. So then he has three main arguments and all of them are assertions that evolutionary history is important. And this is probably not surprising because Gould is a paleontologist, so he's like dealing with evolutionary history. Okay, so one of his first arguments is the idea that historical contingency, so contingency in history, should change the way we think about evolutionary history, and so changes how we think about adaptations. Very simply, Gould's argument is that sometimes there are large, incredibly unpredictable events in evolutionary history. And here he's thinking particularly of mass extinction events. So he's part of a number of paleontologists who really start concentrating on mass catastrophes that result in mass extinctions in the 1980s. And Gould's point is that it's almost like, well, it's not exactly like a lottery, but it's sort of like a lottery where if you have a whole set of organisms that seem to be doing really well in their local environments, and they're suddenly killed off for reasons that have nothing to do with those local circumstances. They get hit by an asteroid, for instance, is a very famous one. If you don't take that into consideration when you look in the future, you will assume that all those that survived, survived because they were better at surviving than those that got hit by the asteroid. A really concrete way of thinking about this is Gould's point is that the dinosaurs didn't go extinct because mammals were better adapted or, you know, sort of more successful from a design perspective. He argues that the dinosaurs went extinct because asteroids hit them, right? And so you can't just infer that those things that are successful in the present were just better adapted. There may have been these totally chance events that influenced the course of evolutionary history. Another argument that Gould makes for the importance of evolutionary history is his argument that sometimes traits in the present should be thought of as developmental byproducts instead of adaptations themselves. So, for instance, if we kind of go back to our beetle example, it could have been the case in the sociobiologist example that the foraging distance of the beetles was simply a function of the length of their legs, right? They forage a certain distance because their legs are a certain length. And perhaps it's the case, I'm just, you know, making this up, that the legs were selected not for foraging benefit, but just in the context of mating. So what you see over time is that you get a concentration of beetles who all have a certain length because of, you know, mating behavior. So when you are here in the present, all of your beetles have a certain leg length, but it was selected for because of mating, not because of foraging distance. And the foraging distance is actually a byproduct of this other trait that was selected. And so Gould's point is that if you just assume that this trait was the thing that was selected for in the past, you sort of get the explanation wrong. And this is the argument that is featured in Spandrels of San Marco. And Gould coins the term spandrel for talking about this kind of developmental byproduct. Now, his most important and iconic argument for the importance of evolutionary history was a theory he proposed with his fellow paleontologist Niles Eldridge called punctuated equilibria. And Eldridge and Gould came to their theory because they were frustrated at traditional interpretations of the fossil record. So in the traditional model of Darwinian gradualistic change, what you assume that you would find when you look at the fossil record is kind of slow incremental change as natural selection kind of carefully, as a careful engineer, moves evolution along. However, when you actually look at the fossil record, so when you're actually looking at the evidence of the fossil record, more often what you get are, rather than a series of finely created forms, a form that's the same and then it abruptly changes. Now, this is something that Darwin noticed from, you know, or as early as 1859, and what he had argued and what people had argued for a long time was that, well, if we had a complete fossil record, we would have all these gradations, it's just the fossils are not there, but maybe they should be. What Eldridge and Gould began to argue was that these gaps were not missing information, they were actually data, they were telling us something about the way that the evolutionary process worked. So what Gould and Eldridge argued is that evolution is characterized by this stasis, rapid evolution, and then continued stasis. So punctuated equilibria, as Gould actually says at points, it's not as a direct a criticism of adaptation as the first two arguments are, but it shifts this focus away from and kind of decreases the understanding of the power of natural selection. So, now, all of these three arguments, again, Gould largely publishes them in technical papers, so he's publishing them in places like Paleobiology, but also Science, Nature, the Royal Society papers, and he's framing them as revisions to Darwinian evolution based on his perspective as a paleontologist, and he's part of this group of paleontologists located at Harvard and elsewhere that are trying to use new models of dealing with data, dealing with large data sets, to argue that the evidence of paleontology is an important thing for all evolutionary biologists to consider. However, in Gould's case, he also believed strongly, and you can see this in his public writing that mirrors these technical writings, he believed strongly that if we understood natural selection only as an engineer, that there were no impediments to its ability as an engineer, we would see the history of life as a series of better and better, more complex, more perfected steps, so that anything that came later in evolutionary history was necessarily better, more further along in evolutionary progress, more perfect. And he believed this way of seeing evolution, evolution as necessarily progressive, he connected it with the history of what he thought of as scientific racism. So for Gould, natural selection as an engineer equals evolutionary progress, which equals racism. That's the sort of connection he's making. So he says in one of his popular books from the early 1980s, he argues that if we imagine evolution as a tale of progress, he believes it's inevitable that we place human variation on a universal scale, that he says, quote, ranks human groups and cultures according to their assumed levels of evolutionary attainment, with not surprisingly white Europeans at the top and their conquered colonies at the bottom. So understanding selection as an optimizer of advancement and complexity leads us to racism in Gould's mind. So in Gould's world, his greatest intellectual foe is racial progress. And Darwin, Charles Darwin, becomes a kind of champion in his cause. So this is the first anthology of his columns. And in this book, Gould claims that Darwin's work had defeated the traditional Western bias towards progress because Darwin proposed natural selection as a theory of local adaptation. Since selection only worked to fit animals to local environments, Gould argued there could be no upward movement towards universal perfection. So in this early moment in Gould's career, he says Darwin defeats racial progress. Now later, he allows the fact that actually there's a lot of progress in Darwin's work. And so he comes to this somewhat more complicated position in the late 1990s where he says something to the effect of Darwin wanted to defeat progress and racism, but he was sort of impeded by his own social context as a Victorian gentleman. And so we have to take the next step to have the fully radical, fully realized version of Darwinism. And so later on, he talks about a kind of higher Darwinism, a Darwinism that is more Darwinian than Darwin was, sort of have to rescue Darwin from his Victorian biases. And this is very much the way that Gould thought about scientific ethics and scientific progress in general, that if we could use history in particular to illuminate the biases of social context, we could kind of go forward into the light. Okay, so moving on. So Gould, his biggest foe is racism. He's arguing with Wilson. They have these different views of how to adjudicate science and ethics. But he's launching all of these criticisms against natural selection just as American creationists are coming forward in the 1980s and also criticizing natural selection. So the kind of heart of this new creationist movement is the work of Henry Morris. This is his 1974 book, Scientific Creationism. And this new creationist movement wanted to introduce a number of measures into the public school system to teach creationism alongside evolution as a kind of alternative. So it's a political program, but also in these creationist documents, they're also criticizing the power of natural selection. So now I made the claim that creationism kind of launches onto the scene in the 1980s, and really the moment that this happens, as I see it, is the McLean v. Arkansas trial in 1981, which is the first what they called equal time court case. It was before the Arkansas Supreme Court case. It set the precedent for a later U.S. Supreme Court case. Gould was actually one of the expert witnesses arguing against creationism, as you probably would assume. Now, what's important around the trial, so Gould's correspondence, but then also a lot of the correspondence that I read in the kind of grassroots organizations, is there's this complete tone of shock and dismay by the biologists, and there's this clear sense that they need to take action against creationism. So they organize themselves to debate creationists, but also denounce creationists. It's a kind of all hands on deck moment. And through the 1980s, there's this outpouring from professional evolutionary biologists, but also philosophers and historians of science, confronting creationism, defeating its arguments, sort of laying the case out before the public. And Gould is right at the center of this. So he is, again, it becomes very notable because he actually testified as a witness against creationists. He writes extensively about creationism in his own column. He makes a lot of the most notable cases against the creationist claims that they're science. But he also writes to all of his biological colleagues. He's very close friends with the second no longer director of the NCSE, Eugenie Scott, and he's on the board of the National Center for Science Education, which is the kind of pro-evolutionary education organization. So again, he's right at the heart of this. So what becomes very strange is Gould is this public face of the defense of evolution against creationism. At the same time, he is criticizing all these fellow evolutionary biologists and saying we need to revise Darwin from the bottom up. And creationists pick up on this and start to say, look, one of the most notable biologists that there is also has problems with Darwinism. It's clearly a flawed issue or flawed science. So in the 1984 edition of Morris's Scientific Creationism, he points to punctuated equilibrium and he says, there is the burgeoning influence of the punctuated equilibrium concept in biology and paleontology. Creationists have long argued that there were no true transitional forms, as neo-Darwinians have always maintained. Now we find leading evolutionists saying the same thing. And not only do creationists pick up on this, the journalists pick up on the fact that the creationists are picking up on this. So in a Discover magazine article from 1982, there's a journalist who notices that the creationists are seeing punctuated equilibrium as an opening. And the article said, among paleontologists, scientists who study the fossil record, there is growing dissent from the prevailing view of Darwinism. Partly as a result of the disagreements among scientists, the fundamentalists are successfully reintroducing creationism textbooks across the United States. Eldridge and Gould count themselves among Darwin's scientific heirs. They do not dispute his basic theories, but says Gould, Darwinism as a set of ideas is sufficiently broad to include a multitude of truths and sins. So Gould's trying to revise Darwinism. The creationists pick up on this. The journalists pick up on this. And so all of a sudden you have your most public defender of evolution kind of embroiled in all of this creationist controversy. And so what happens? Well, what happens in sort of other corners of the biological community, many of the same writers and thinkers who were part of the sociobiology, I won't say revolution, but kind of research program, start to understand natural selection as the best defense against creationism. And this is because they read creationism as primarily being an argument about design, right? So God designs the world, not natural selection. So a number of biologists turn their intellectual energy, their intellectual fight towards fighting creationism. And they rest upon natural selection as the kind of key linchpin or the key piece in their arguments against what they see as the creationist arguments. So Gould is doing all this sort of complex, let us revive Darwinism to think about historical contingency. A number of other biologists, not Wilson so much, but many people who worked kind of around Wilson's program, say, no, actually we need to double down on natural selection because natural selection is what defeats the creationist arguments for design. And the most notable and clear instance of this and where it really begins is in Richard Dawkins' The Blind Watchmaker. I imagine many of you are very familiar with who Richard Dawkins is. No, you've never heard of him before. So Richard Dawkins is, I mean you could say, but so Richard Dawkins is still a very famous public science writer, who was also involved in ethological research in Britain in the 1970s. So Richard Dawkins had been involved in his earlier book, The Selfish Gene, in arguing for the engineering power of natural selection, saying that the engineering power of natural selection is what gives us sex difference, it's what gives us human nature, all of those sociobiological arguments that Gould was so critical of. Here he shifts that engineering power and he says, additionally, what this engineering power does is it enables us to explain the living world without God. So he acknowledges that, he sort of says, like, I have a kind of sympathy, I'm putting his words in his mouth, I don't get this, but he has a kind of sympathy with the creationists, right? The world is so complex, it's so amazing, we are tempted to explain it as the handiwork of a supreme creator. Since, but we don't have to do that any longer. Natural selection, the engineering capacity of natural selection, allows us to understand the world as entirely naturalistic. So in Dawkins' hands, the ability of natural selection to explain complex, adaptive features of organisms becomes not only the most important feature of evolutionary theory, he sort of turns it into a cornerstone of materialism and naturalistic rationality. It's like the thing that the scientific worldview hinges upon. And in a very famous quote from the beginning of this book, Dawkins actually says, Darwin, by this he means natural selection, made it possible to be an intellectually fulfilled atheist. Now, what we see is there's a kind of heightened stakes for adaptation are clear in Dawkins' changing rhetoric across this period. So just a few years before the blind watchmaker, in his book, The Extended Phenotype, Dawkins has a lot more room for alternative views of evolution. So he says at one point in the book, if a molecular geneticist interested in gene substitutions or a paleontologist interested in major trends argues with an ecologist, i.e. a sociobiologist, interested in adaptation, they're likely to find themselves at cross purposes simply because each of them emphasizes a different aspect of what evolution means. So here he says, you know, we have different disciplinary views, we have different tools, we're all sort of one big happy family, and later in that section he says, you know, we're all on the side of Darwin, this is all Darwinism, you know, we're sort of parsing things here. However, after the creationist controversy, after he publishes The Blind Watchmaker, Dawkins is far more clear about the set of adaptation being the essential core of Darwinian theory. And he and Gould engaged in a public debate at Oxford University in 1988, where Dawkins makes his point extremely clear. So Dawkins says in this public debate, for me, the most important thing Darwinism has to offer is its explanations of adaptation. Of course, Darwinism can offer explanations of other things than adaptation. For instance, the pattern of diversity. Here's a kind of explicit nod towards Gould as a paleontologist. But if Darwinism wasn't there, plenty of other theories could plausibly explain them. But they couldn't explain adaptive complexity. Only natural selection could do that. Suppose to take an analogy. A substance is discovered which turns out to be a miracle cure for AIDS. Nothing else is known that can cure AIDS. And this wonder substance is infallible. Now suppose that that substance also turns out to be useful for stuffing cushions. Shall we refer to it as the cure for AIDS or as a cushion stuffer? Of course, it's both, but we should think of it as mainly as a cure for AIDS, because firstly, lots of other substances can be used to stuff cushions, whereas no other substance is known to cure AIDS. And secondly, curing AIDS is a lot more important than stuffing cushions anyway. So, I mean, this is particularly interesting because it's the 1980s and he's talking about AIDS, but it's clear that the disease that Dawkins has in mind is religion as a disease of the mind. So his point is that I suppose we can use Darwinian evolution to explain other things like the history of life, but who cares about that? We need it to explain why religion and theistic belief are not plausible, why they're intellectually bankrupt. So what I really found in my work was that the criticisms of creationists really heightens the explanatory significance of adaptationism for evolutionary biologists. And so in reaction, many interpreted Gould's criticisms, either his biological colleagues or journalists or historians as well, they interpreted his critiques of adaptation as attacks on the power of natural selection to explain the world without design. So there's an explicit example of this from 1986 when one sociobiologist responded directly to claim that Gould made in one of his natural history columns, and Gould claimed that male nipples were not adaptations but developmental byproducts, that they were spandrels. So writing to the editor of Natural History, the sociobiologist John Alcock claimed, the adaptationist position is an invitation to scientific investigation. If the predictions fail, then we can rule out the hypotheses, but let's not reject the plausible possibilities out of hand. So in Alcock's mind, Gould's emphasis on development, his scenario of a byproduct, was not an alternative evolutionary account, but it's an account that's rendered no longer scientific. And what I found was that in the writings of sociobiologists, the ability of natural selection to explain adaptive complexity became the most and sort of only salient feature of evolution, and the public duty and sort of ethical commitment for evolutionary biologists was to defend evolution broadly, but to defend natural selection in particular. So what I contend is that by the end of the 20th century, there are really two versions of Darwinism, and even two versions of Darwin, that emerge from the debates between Gould and the sociobiologists. So Gould has a Darwin that ended evolutionary progress and was a champion against racism, whereas Dawkins' Darwin had disproven the argument from design and defeated religion. But it's the Darwin as the enemy of religion that really holds the most sway at the end of the 20th century. You can see this really clearly in American consumer culture from the last 30 or so years, where this is a period when things like the sort of Darwin fish and the Christian fish face off on bumper stickers. Darwin's image explodes in American media in a way that's really unprecedented. Before 1980, you see Darwin tattoos starting to be circulated. And this sort of celebration of Darwin as a figure, and Darwin as a figure of scientific revolution, scientific materialism, anti-creationist sentiment, sort of emphasizes how important Darwin as the enemy of religion becomes in the American context. So this strengthening of themes of science and religion around Darwin really capture these larger scale changes in American politics around scientific authority, something I began this with. So one of the things that's so interesting about these images is that they move in spaces and register with audiences that are even beyond these Darwinian celebrities that I've talked about. So even though we have creationist authors who carefully watch the debates between professional scientists, there are actually far larger audiences in the American context whose acquaintance with the creationist debates are through bumper stickers and t-shirts, through church leaflets, or through local campaigns waged to introduce creationism in the public classroom. And in these early years of the Christian right, when creationism becomes part, the sort of intuitive part of this new evangelical identity, when Republican politicians questioned Darwinian evolution during election season, they were not actually dealing with these technical debates around natural selection. Rather, their publicly doubting evolution was one way to align with voters on an entire political and religious worldview, one that was committed to the heterosexual nuclear family and to pride in American exceptionalism. And so as this happens, as this sort of massive change happens, Gould's version of Darwin, the Darwin who could propel a radical politics, a Darwin whose central theory could be revised, actually fades into the background of public imagination. And the altercations between Darwin and creationism and Darwin and God were just far more compellingly intertwined in the nation's cultural and political debates. Thank you so much for listening to me today. I look forward to your questions. Yes, in the back.
So you started with a contrast between Gould and Wilson, and then the end transitioned to a contrast between Gould and Dawkins.
Yes.
And then the impacts on science versus religion. Gould and Wilson hold much more, or Gould held much more compatible views about the relationship between science and religion than do either one with Dawkins.
Yes.
How does that fit into this idea of the sort of differences between sociobiology and anti-sociobiology and adaptationists versus non-adaptationists?
Yeah, that's a wonderful question. So on the one hand, the kind of particular views of these various Darwinian celebrities are important for understanding the trajectory of their careers and their differences with one another. I'm even more interested in them for how they can help us map these large-scale political changes, and then also what I see as these shifting stakes around technical debates. So I like your question because it highlights that Gould continues to criticize Wilson or criticize sociobiology or criticize adaptation, which for him, and he's very explicit more in correspondence than he is in published spaces, he sees this kind of one big package, one big issue in evolutionary biology. And so the argument is that creationism sort of hardens the sociobiology insistence on a way of viewing natural selection and makes it much more difficult for Gould to criticize natural selection. Now, in terms of you know, the differences that various Darwinian celebrities felt compelled to kind of deal with creationism or deal with religion, even though they have varying views on how compatible religion writ large can be with science, they all agree that American creationism is problematic. Wilson is probably the least vocal, I would say, on this. And there is this kind of wholesale sense of creationism in particular is something that all biologists, kind of no matter their religious background use or even persuasion, is something that they should combat. So Gould, for instance, and I didn't say this clearly, felt it was perfectly possible for evolution and some kind of religion to be compatible, but he felt this particular form of creationism was not. So the important point is that the specifics of American creationism create this very specific and very compelling moral duty for all the evolutionary biologists, no matter their own particular religious persuasion or background. I mean, Gould is Jewish, so. Yeah.
So, following on something you said, you pointed out that Wilson backed down from his response to Gould in that Evolutionary magazine. And then you look at the trajectory of Wilson's career, and he didn't really wind up defending the sociobiology, or he didn't go into, he wasn't conflicting with Gould as he went on in his career. His political fight he chose to go with was much more defending by adversity.
Yeah.
And so if he was going to have a political fight, that's the one he was choosing for the latter half of his career. And I'm wondering if you think that he was persuaded by Gould in terms of concerns about scientific racism, if he saw that as this maybe is a dark path that it could go down if you pursue sociobiology. Was Wilson persuaded by that at all?
I don't think he was persuaded even in the slightest, actually. So two things here. One is that, so for Gould, he sees sociobiology as primarily an issue of racism. And I think that this is, or I tend to think of this as because his own participation in the civil rights movement, but also his kind of consciousness of his own ethnic background. He sort of often frames himself as being an Eastern European Jewish person and kind of in the landscape of mid-century Northeastern American academic politics that is a distinctive ethnicity. Whereas sociobiologists are really more invested in sex difference and gender difference. And so the criticisms, the political criticisms of sociobiology really come from feminist scientists, feminist philosophers, and that's what takes up and goes through the 80s and 90s. And so Wilson altercates with feminists pretty distinctly through the rest of his career. So I think you can see consilience, his book Consilience, and a kind of insistence on a certain way of viewing science from the Enlightenment as a pushback against feminists. I think that Wilson felt that it's a little bit of a walk, actually, that Gould gets to in order to accuse sociobiology of promoting racism, right? He has to say sociobiology is invested in a form of thinking about natural selection. This form of thinking about natural selection leads to progress. Progress is something that leads to racism, right? He's not actually saying that the sociobiologists are dividing people according to race or that they're invested in racial categories. In fact, they're really not. So Wilson, I don't think, ever believed or took on those criticisms. Yeah?
So another one of the fact that Gould sort of aligned himself with against the sociobiology and sort of biological determinism, which, in my recollection, is also one of arguments that Gould and Levins were perhaps speaking. But I'd like to, can you comment on the extent to which so I remember there was some essays, an evolutionary essay where they talk about the point. Do you think that was a side point of this critique? Or how was the influence, how did the ruling go on the lines?
Yeah, so that's really important. Thank you. So the column that I pointed out is actually called like biological potential versus biological determinism. And so sort of to clarify, so Gould is criticizing Wilson for being biologically deterministic or being one in a long history of biological determinism. And by this he simply means using biology to give a rationale for or to say that our current social situation has to be this way because of biology. And in his public criticisms of Wilson, and also in a book he was going to put together with a historian of science, Gar Allen, that wasn't actually ever published, but was called Biological Determinism. He locates sociobiology at the end of a history of what he describes as problematic moments of biological determinism, And for this, he talks about like craniometry and eugenics, and he sort of sees sociobiology as nothing new. It's just his feeling is that we always want to use science to say that the current makeup of the world is the way that it has to be, so how could we change it? So that's very much in his criticism of sociobiology in kind of a rhetorical and kind of socially contextual level. What I find interesting is that parallels his kind of technical criticisms of the evolutionary process. So it's sort of interesting. On the one hand, he will acknowledge a point like, yes, I have a leftist background. Like, yes, his father was a very devoted Marxist. He says, I'm sure that this influences my liking for radical politics and a kind of radical way of thinking of evolutionary history. But I believe everyone is, and all scientists are influenced by their social context. And what the ethical duty of scientists is then is to use history in particular to reflect upon the errors of science so that we can move forward. And that's really what he's doing with his book, The Mismeasure of Man, which comes out in 1982. So he says, The Mismeasure of Man is on the history of race and intelligence testing. He says, like, look, we can use history to see in the past the way that scientists have been biologically deterministic, and if we're reflective about this, this can allow us to move forward with better science.
Michael Russo's book, The Mystery of History, is when he discusses Gould, he specifically summarizes his career as having very little of the way biology is. He specifically refers to Humphrey's Equilibria, the paper, and the number of citations, but the way he describes very little. And the way he frames it is, while he had a very influential public career, as an evolutionary biologist, he had very little impact to the discussion that was interesting.
So he makes a very loaded assertion in that book. It's maybe, and I'll just say this, I won't necessarily comment on it. The book is introduced by E. Wilson, that particular book, so it's an interesting thing. And Michael Ruse is a philosopher and historian of science, and in the introduction, Wilson describes him as a like war correspondent. So he was someone who commented on these Darwinian debates, but also sort of participated in them. So assessing his assessment is itself a kind of contentious thing. What I will say is that in my work, particularly when I've spoken with or read the paleontological literature, it's sort of taken very much for granted that, although not all of the particulars of Gould's theories are exactly the way that people understand that punctuated equilibrium is a live and very important theory in paleontology. The other field that kind of looks to Gould as a starter is evo-devo. So people in evolutionary developmental biology locate ontogeny and phylogeny as a, not exactly, they don't take the models from their best, but it's kind of inspiring thinking about development. So now, it's just from the beginning a way of dismissing a scientist to say, they've only made an impact in the public and they have made no impact in the scientific realm, right? In terms of, you know, how much did Gould's theories have purchase in working evolutionary biology? I mean, if we sort of look in bibliographic citations or discussions of these papers, they certainly generate and animate a great deal of discussion and a great deal of working through, like, how do we understand what selection is? You know, whether or not this means that Gould is like the lasting tower of revising Darwinism that I believe he wanted to be, I mean, that's much harder to say. But he didn't want to be. Like, he wanted to be the next Darwin, but everybody does, so.
Let's thank Dr. Sheldon for an excellent presentation.